All right, okay. Hello everyone, and welcome to our environmental justice mural reveal today. For those of you who don't already know me, my name is Andre Forsyth, and we're coming live from our first environmental justice mural today. We'll get into the discussion and meeting everybody very shortly, but first, before we do that, I wanted to start off with a land acknowledgement. I do want to call out that while we have most of our partners in this mural on the call today, unfortunately, one of our most vivacious partners, Denise Hampton, who works with Christopher Wilson at the Center for Black Trade, Coalition for Black Trade Unionists, has unfortunately been able to join us. That is the reality of our COVID world right now. So while she will be missed, she was able to put together a beautiful land acknowledgement. So I'm going to read that on her behalf, and then we'll get into the rest of our reveal today. So I'll apologize in advance. I don't have the soothing voice that Denise brings, but I'll do my best. So here we go. Since long before explorers and conquerors from Europe arrived on the shores of Turtle Island, there were several distinct nations of people living on this land with thriving communities and cultures. The original stewards of this land on First Nations, Inuit, and Métis territories were also the first storytellers, artists, performers, and musicians. For tens of thousands of years, Indigenous people throughout Turtle Island have been singing songs and telling stories in languages that were spoken in these trees long before English or French were. For millennia, people learned, traded, celebrated, raised families, and coexisted on this land, all while respecting the earth as the mother that sustains us all. We must not forget this, and we must honor it. The foundation of those cultures was the leadership of elders and the legacies of the ancestors. Elders played and still play a pivotal role in structuring communities, and elders are the keepers of knowledge, and as such, they had a responsibility to share and to educate using storytelling, music, beadwork, and so many other visual arts, including painting. Colonialism changed all of that. There's a long, extensive, and sometimes ignored history of the violent effects of colonialism on Indigenous people from the Arctic Circle to Tierra del Fuego, the southernmost region of South America. Recently, there has been a public and persistent rise of activism and fighting against the ravages of colonialism on those who welcomed the first settlers. As beneficiaries of colonialism, we have a responsibility to also fight for the rights of Indigenous people wherever those rights are threatened. In June of 2015, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission issued a report with 94 calls to action detailing how governments and organizations and ordinary Canadians could begin the long process of repairing the damage to Indigenous people caused by colonialism and specifically residential schools. Calls to action 79 to 86 speak specifically to the arts. I encourage you to read them, learn about them, and support Indigenous art and artists in all of the many mediums that we love. As we spend this time celebrating the arts and artists, we salute the Indigenous artists who have come before us and we honor their memory. We also want to acknowledge the Indigenous children that were forced to attend residential schools throughout Canada and the United States, Turtle Island. These children were taken by force, tortured, beaten, and in some cases murdered. We especially remember the children who didn't come home from those institutions. Finally, I encourage you to find out where the nearest residential school was to you and your own community and learn about its history. So, what a wonderful way to begin our series for tonight. I thank Denise, though she couldn't be here to join us, for putting that together and making that particularly relevant to the arts and the role that arts is going to play in this conversation today. So before we get to the reveal, I want to take the chance to introduce all of our partners who are on the call today. That being said, if you guys all want to come off mute and Chris, why don't I start with you? Let us know who you are and who you work with.
Sure. Thank you very much for that introduction. So Christopher Wilson, I'm the first vice president to the Coalition of Black Trade Unionists. I'm also a co-investigator in an environmental racism research project in partnership with CBTU and York University, adapting Canadian work and workplaces to respond to climate change. Thank you, Andre.
Thank you, Chris. Seth, you want to jump in there?
Hi, Andre. Hello, everyone. I'm Seth Klein. I'm joining you with gratitude from the unceded territories of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh Nations, otherwise known as Vancouver. I'm so glad this project is happening. Congratulations to everyone. Andre, did you want me to say a little something?
Not yet. We're going to get back to that. After the mural comes out, we've created space for you since Seth is just some insight. Seth has carved out some time to join us today. So thank you for making that time. So as soon as we reveal the mural, then we'll have you first to speak. Wonderful. I'm going to go to Tony.
Hello. It's me. So I'm Tony. I'm one of the co-founders of Plastic Free Toronto. I'll let Lynn tell you what Plastic Free Toronto is. Lynn, go ahead. Hello, I'm Lynn, the other half of Plastic Free Toronto. We are an education-based, community resource / group working to, inform people about environmental injustice, social injustice, and, work towards a better future with all of you lovely, beautiful people who are here today. So that's exciting. Tony's a doctor. I'm an actor in our spare time.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynn. And last but not least, Nolo.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nolo Charles from the Black Environmental Initiative, also co-founder of the National Anti-Environmental Racism Coalition with the Enrich Project. I'm happy to be here.
Awesome. And thank you guys all for keeping that so short. We're going to have plenty of time to learn more about you, which is half the reason that we're here today. But I think the main reason we're all here today is to reveal this mural. We'll get more into the background of how this project, what the project is and how it came to be. As you know, if you're attending today, this is a project of the School for Climate is a project of Canadian Climate Challenge. We have brought, pivoting in this COVID world, we've brought the arts and climate challenge to get, and addressing climate solution issues into the streets, because while we would normally be dealing with this and launching an indoor exhibition, we don't have time to wait to share this information. So that's what launched us into creating in this year of public art to bring those learnings into the communities that they represent and make sure that the accessibility is there. So that being said, we'll get way more into that. And let's go to Brett so that we can reveal the actual mural that we've been working on for this past month. No one else on this call has seen that. I will say the partners have been dying to see it. But this is the first time that anyone other than those who were there working on it are seeing it live. So let's go to Brett. If everyone else can mute themselves, and then Brett, you can come on.
Hello. This is what you've all been waiting for.
Not on. Oh my God, you have to zoom in closer, right? Zoom in closer. Did you see? It was too short, right? Hold on. Don't worry. I knew that she was going to be short, so I've got her back here for us to put on screen. All right.
Okay.
Welcome, Danilo. Can we all?
How you doing?
Be here now.
Can you hear me? Okay. Check 1, 2.
And so we can all come off mute now.
Looks amazing.
Wow.
Congratulations.
Can you can we zoom in on the words? Is that possible?
Absolutely. So that, which is a great place to start. So first let me just welcome Danilo to the call. Danilo Deluxo is the artist who's brought this piece to life. Since February 1st is when we started, the first day we put paint up on the wall. And as we get into the call later, we'll be sharing the video of how the whole process of it coming to life. But Danilo Deluxo, who also worked on the Toronto sign that we all know very well, amongst his other incredible body of work, we're very honored to work with. So thank you, Danilo, for joining. And just before we get into the discussion with Danilo on how this came to be and getting more into the piece, I just want to say it's been a pleasure working with Danilo. The many days that we were on site until 3 a.m. If anyone is ever considering doing a mural in February in Toronto again, minus 16 nights at 3 a.m. is a reality that you're just going to have to embrace. So thank you. Working with that work ethic and the commitment to this piece, I just wanted to start off by thanking you for that, welcoming you to this call. And let's get, so that this part of the discussion, we're going to get into the piece, background, how Danilo approaches, and find out more about what that's been like. But as Lynn asked, so the quote there, should I read it?
Yes, please.
Yes. Absolutely.
Okay. So an artist, as you saw from the larger piece, the person depicted is Nina Simone. This is one of her most well-known quotes. An artist's duty, as far as I'm concerned, is to reflect the times. I think that is true of painters, sculptors, poets, musicians. At this crucial time in our lives, when everything is so desperate, when every day is a matter of survival, I don't think you can help but be involved. Young people, Black and white, know this. That's why they're so involved in politics. So I don't think you have a choice. How can you be an artist and not reflect the times? That, to me, is the definition of an artist.
Powerful.
So powerful.
I mean, I'll let Danilo go more into it, but while Nina, as we know, the times that she sacrificed her career to ensure she was fighting for civil rights, what the rights that we're talking about and why this piece is so important is environmental justice rights. And that's why it was important for us to call out how relevant those words and her choice as an artist to put her career on the line, to take a very successful career that has defined a genre of music and put that on the line in order to make sure that she's involved in that fight was the reason that she was chosen for this, and the language that we feel like was most supportive of the fight for environmental justice. So I don't want to talk over, that's my piece so far. Danilo, by all means, so let's get started. If you want to do a small intro, I don't know if I did you enough justice, but come on in.
Yeah, I think you did. You definitely did. Thank you. Just to start off, this was, I'm Danilo Deluxo. And this was an incredible experience working with the School for Climate and all of the partners that have been involved, as well as with the Poetry Jazz Cafe, you know, a really epic place in Kensington Market and in Toronto. But, you know, working on this project for environmental justice, and specifically, you know, with these with you guys as organizations, it's been really incredible. You know, we did some late nights as Andre has alluded to, but it's been really powerful. And of course, representing Nina Simone in this fight for awareness around climate change and environmental justice, it's an epic moment. It's really incredible.
I couldn't agree more. And anybody else, feel free to jump in. So I don't know if you guys can all see. So Nina's depicted in a very specific way here. Danilo, do you want to give us some background as to how that came to be?
Yeah, absolutely. Do you have the image there?
Yeah, it's in the background. It's on the screen here.
It's on the screen here. The back end theme is the World War II posters. And what we did with this is we took that theme. Me as an Afrofuturist artist, you know, we're celebrating Black History Month as well as Black Future Month. And myself as an Afrofuturist artist, what we chose to do was take this epic image, this iconic image from World War II propaganda, from World War II posters of Rosie the Riveter, and, you know, implement a Black woman in place of Rosie the Riveter. And of course, it's not just any Black woman, you know, it's Nina Simone. So, I'm not sure. You said the image is in the back. It is.
We've got her here. I'm going to cut you off just for a quick second.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just because I want to get Seth's reaction. So I'm just going to call it a quick question to Seth. For those of you who are not familiar with Seth Klein, he wrote a book called A Good War last year in 2020, which really does an exceptional job. For anyone who hasn't read it yet, get it now, buy it for your friends, gift it to your friends, which lays out the roadmap for what does Canada need to do to drive the systemic change that we need in order to not only adapt, but to thrive as we face this pivotal moment. And of course, one of the main things that he had highlighted in there is a World War II scale level of mobilization. So Seth, if you could jump in and give us your reaction, given that idea of what you were thinking, how that would come to life, and in respect to the mural reveal you've seen here today, love to hear your thoughts before you have to leave us.
Yeah, apologies. I have to leave in a minute to pick up a kid at school, but Danilo, congratulations. It's gorgeous. That quote from Nina Simone is so prescient. It's like she had some telescope into the future to this moment we're in right now. And it's like perfect for today.
And I
I love the World War II Rosie poster there. So my book, you know, like yours, project, draws its inspiration from the Second World War story. Every great mobilization needs the arts, and the climate mobilization is no different. And the arts played a huge role in the societal mobilization. You know, at the start of the war, many people assumed the public were already there and ready to rally. And that's not true. It took a lot of work to get the public engaged, and artists were there. You know, painters went to the front to document the fight, filmmakers pumped out films, artists produced these ubiquitous posters to rally us and recruit us like the one you have. And musicians produced a popular soundtrack for that fight. And we need the same thing today. Mobilizations have to appeal to our heart as well as our head. It's so great to see like this project, artists starting to produce creative works that speak to the climate emergency. Much of the work, you know, not this, is very dystopian. And that makes sense at a certain level, right? It's a scary time, and we're all motivated in this fight, at least in part by fear. but we're also motivated by hope and love. And you know, it's interesting, the World War II art, even as horrific as the war was, it wasn't dystopian. You know, the tone and feel of it rallied us. And to see, you know, I think that's the challenge for arts today, and to see you seeding that new body of work, super exciting, and drawing the connections with inequality. You know, that was part of the World War II mobilization too. People understood that if you're gonna mobilize society, inequality is toxic to that social solidarity that we need. That's the echo today of the promise of the Green New Deal. And so embedding the fight for justice within the climate mobilization, this is a great little way to kick it off and to peak our, to recapture and blow open our sense of imagination and possibility in this moment. So congratulations, everyone.
Well, thank you. And I know you have to go. And so I would be remiss if we didn't just take this opportunity before you leave to really thank you and to really call out how much of an inspiration the work that you've done has been in helping us direct what we need to do next. The scale of public mobilization, the call for artists to be involved, how essential that is in terms of a public education, and for us to get success, no way we would have been able to rise to this call without you making that call for us. So thank you very much. I look forward for us to discuss more, and I look forward to working with you as we continue this series together.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, wonderful. Okay, so Danilo, the spotlight's back on you. But I'm gonna try and not talk for a sec. Try. The word is try. So from the rest of our partners, it's your first time seeing it. Reactions, questions for Danilo. Shoot them.
I have a question. What? Oh, wait, who wants to go first?
No, you go first. You go first.
Okay. So I love that the wording, like the way it's framed, is environmental justice.
Yes.
And like, to me, that means something. I'm curious to hear what your interpretation of and like why you chose to do it that way. Because for me, like, but when I look at it that way, like my first thought is just like, yes, it's absolutely mental that we still do not have environmental justice. Like, it's absolutely mental that people do not have clean drinking water still, that like all of these things. So yeah, I just wanted to hear from you on like what, how that idea came to you and what that means to you.
Yeah, I think so it's a great pull up from the piece. Working with Andre and working with the team, splitting up the words that way, you know, where, you know, mental was on its own or had its own line, just focus the idea back that like it's obviously like a, you know, action that we have to take, but it's also a psychological, you know, it's a psychological frame of mind that we have to approach this fight with. And you know, also for me anyway personally, like just the, you know, a lot of conversation around mental stability, especially during COVID and with you know, the twin pandemics that we're facing right now. But that psychological, that mental frame of mind and framing kind of was important to just kind of break it up in terms of environmental justice. It's cool that, you know, what you took from it also was like, this is mental, that it hasn't, you know what I mean? That people are still not waking up. That's mental. But yeah, I think for me, it was just that it's a mental, psychological frame of mind that we kind of have to come to terms with and like take action with, because obviously before the action, you have to have that that shift, that paradigm shift in terms of the mind.
And Lynn, I'd love to hear, so, I mean, you obviously called it out. What was your thought when you saw that?
Yeah, no, for me, it's just like, every time I think about or hear stories about. Okay, let me put it this way. I didn't even know about environmental racism in this country, or just as a term, as an idea, until probably like a year or two ago. And that alone, the fact that like it was just something that was completely off my radar in terms of like, you know, you can be aware of certain areas of Toronto or areas of like around where you live being, you know, less affluent, and like you can sort of see that there's like class divides in that sense, but then to realize the implications of that and how deep that goes and what that affects in terms of like how the cities are planned, who is, it's just the depth of that and my lack of my personal lack of awareness around that was really astounding to me, because it's just like, it's so easy to live in a bubble and to like not, I guess, be aware of your own privilege. And I think that as we go forward to create a more just society, like one of the first things that would really help is some education around these issues and making them very transparent, as well as like making our colonial history way more transparent. Because it's really like, when I think back to my school days, it's like a small page or two in the books of like, yeah, we did some things like residential schools that you mentioned, like that was probably like brushed over, like, yeah, it happened, it's over, and it's actually not over yet. So it's just, I think that reframing and retelling of these stories in a very current way to increase the awareness of what is currently going on in this city, in this country, is so important. And like bringing this message to people is absolutely essential, because it's mental to me that we do not know about all of the injustices going on. And like, you can't help people if you don't know about it, you know?
No, yeah. I mean, so. I agree completely. I'm just gonna deviate for 1 second. I mean, because for me, that was one of the, when Danilo and I worked together a lot in these conversations and bringing this together. And when he structured it like that, environmental justice, similar to you guys, is recently on my radar within the past few years, and all the different ways and learnings about it. But then breaking it into enviro, then mental, then justice, it just highlights the, I had forgotten that mental was just as powerful a segment as the whole word environmental together, and the weight of that on there. So when he chose to structure it that way, I almost cried. And not that I was the only one who cried in respect to this project, but we could get back to that in a sec. I just want to, so I'm gonna switch our background for a second, because I really, one of the things that we were very lucky for, and then we can come back into this conversation. One of the things we were very lucky about was to be a part of this process and watching it come to life. So our videographer who you saw earlier, Brett, has created a video. I'm gonna play 1 minute to introduce it, and then we'll all have it go into the background as we continue our discussion, if that's okay. So here we go. Okay, here we go.
An artist's duty, as far as I'm concerned, is to reflect the times. I think that is true of painters, sculptors, poets, musicians. As far as I'm concerned, it's their choice. But I choose to reflect the times and the situations in which I find myself. That to me is my duty. And at this crucial time in our lives, when everything is so desperate, when every day is a matter of survival, I don't think you can help but be involved. Young people, black and white, know this. That's why they're so involved in politics. We will shape and mold this country. It will not be molded and shaped at all anymore. So I don't think you have a choice. How can you be an artist and not reflect the times? That to me is a definition of an artist.
If So I mean, the video just gets so powerful. But I mean, I read the quote out earlier, and it just does not do justice to when Nina says, "Okay, Chris, you don't have to agree so vehemently that
I had to agree." You know, I love you, brother, but it's like nobody could do Nina Simone like Nina Simone.
No, absolutely not. They definitely can't. Let me just make sure we're sharing the right area. Perfect. Yeah. So, Chris, actually, I'd love to get your feedback on the mural and what your thoughts are.
Sure. Well, I needed to share with some of the feedback that's coming out from CB2 members who are just blowing up the WhatsApp here. Just a couple comments here. Yes. The mural is absolutely amazing, stunning. It is beautiful, and Nina Simone's words still are relevant today. Yes, beautiful mural, amazing work. So yeah, you definitely, this is my first time seeing it, you know, and all I got to say is you came through for CBTU. The membership couldn't be happier with the work that you've done. You know, just a couple quick questions for you, looking at the mural. One thing I reflect on as a union organizer is the question of what does it take to move somebody to take action? My question to you as an artist is, what is it about art that has the capacity to move people in a way that text may not? And then the second question I had from you, you know, looking at it from a trade union's perspective, I noticed at the bottom left-hand corner of the mural, you had people picketing. What was the connection you saw between that sort of class action and Nina Simone's call to speak to our time? So those are my two questions for you. And thank you again for this work. It's just stunning.
Sorry, who's that question directed towards, Chris?
I was gonna direct it towards you.
Oh, okay.
Danilo, yeah.
Sorry, I'm just watching the video. I don't know if my internet is on lapse or what. Sorry, you're gonna have to ask those questions again.
Not a problem. So my two questions were, one, what is it about art that has the capacity to move people in a way that text may not?
Yes.
The other question I had for you was around the image.
One at a time, Chris.
Okay, let's start with that one.
One at a time. take it as it comes, right?
Okay, for sure.
So yeah, I mean, it's an important question, especially in these times when, you know, I think a lot of us as artists also are struggling with the idea of, like, is art as creatives, you know, is it considered essential? Is it essential? Is it non-essential? But for me, and I think for a lot of us, art has that capacity to tap into, definitely to our emotions, to sometimes make us see and feel things that are, you know, intellectually, you know, I don't know how people are not moved by the whole situation with our climate, but like emotionally, you know, humans are emotional beings, and art has that ability to cut through, you know what I mean? Like, you know, we experienced this a couple of times, me and Andre, you know, some people were crying, you know, they saw the piece and they were like, in tears, moved by it, you know what I mean? And so that is that ability, of course, you know, listening to Nina Simone on a dark night, you know, listening to Nina, you're gonna feel what she's talking about. And you can feel it in the artist's voice, as a musician, you know, you're listening to like Strange Fruit or, you know, I Put a Spell on You, you feel it, you know, and it makes you possibly, and you know, see and hear and feel a perspective that you may not have had before, but you start to feel it, and you know, cause you to. I think for me, the thing is like the shift, you know, the mental and emotional, the shift that you individuals have within themselves, and then the action comes, you know, the action, the call to action, but there has to be like a mental, a shift of mind. And, you know, like a lot of people, I think art is one of those last frontiers that actually can enable people to make that shift, you know. Another realm, you know, that comes into my head is like comedy. There's a lot of stand-up comedy these days talking about really political things, you know. But art and these things, they have that way of getting past our defenses and making us feel, you know. And of course, you know, as they say, an image tells 1,000 words, you know, and then it's also, you know, interpretable. People are going to take different things from it. But of course, you know, as we said, like the message behind this piece is like, it's like a call to action. Hearing, you know, seeing and reading Nina's words, it's like a call to action for artists, musicians, creatives, and just people from our community to become more involved in, you know, the struggle for environmental justice and climate change. Yeah.
And if I can tag on to that just for a quick.
Yeah, tag on, man. Tag.
I'll just talk the whole call, guys. You guys are just here for windows. I think what speaks to that, so they, as you said, Chris and Danilo, the ability for certain mediums to transcend the divisions that seem to define our daily interactions, through the process of bringing this mural to life, the array of people who stop by to make a comment or weigh in, by no means were all of these people all climate activists or on the side of climate. Like we have the complete spectrum in there. However, seeing that a location like Poetry Jazz Cafe in Kensington Market, which is iconic in the city, and seeing that they've chosen to go over Miles, which is Miles Davis, who was there beforehand. And if you ever speak to the owner, and I encourage you to go to Poetry and speak to the owner once, that's not illegal, and how important that was to him, for that piece was to him, and how important it had to be, a strong message that was relevant to now if he was going to go over that. And I think the choosing of all of that together, the choosing of what an artist does, and the ability for art and music to reach you on an emotional level that then becomes the center for grounding the perspective and for how you maybe reassess maybe a previous perspective that you held, is then grounded in that emotional connection. And so I seeing that happen in real time in Kensington throughout this past 3 weeks has been for me one of the most incredible moments for us. So yeah, sorry Chris, sorry to jump in there.
No, don't apologize.
Yeah. So I don't know if you answered your second question, or
why don't I hold on to my second question to give other people a chance to speak as well. But I really appreciate that time on that first question. So insightful.
Wonderful. Actually, absolutely, I would love to hear, Chris. Nolo, Tony, we're going to come back to you because you haven't said much yet. And I know you're an opinionated woman, so for sure. But Nolo, I would love to hear your reaction or your thoughts for sure.
Well, I think it's great. I've been really thinking about the contrast between the mural and this original picture with the white lady on it, where she's alone. She shows a strength with just like this sign. And in this mural, you have actually a crowd of people behind Nina Simone. That means, you know, the collective mobilization versus individual strength. And I think that's an important message in what we're trying to do here. And even just thinking that you were trying to do some type of a version of that, it looks so different. And I think it's great that it looks different, because it shows that we're actually telling a different story. And the last thing I was thinking about is how, if you look at the original picture with, I don't remember how they call it, with the white lady on it.
Yeah, Rosie the Riveter.
Rosie the Riveter.
There's no, it's just strength. We're powerful and that's it, right? And when you look at the mural, it tells you environmental justice. So it's the type of empowerment we're trying to do is connected to the social issues. It's not just coming up to say we want to be powerful. So, and I think that's an important message as well.
I appreciate that so much, Nolo. And this is what I love. And to your point earlier, Chris, is each person's reaction to it is incredible. So that resonating for Nolo and calling out that segment of the action that is then inspired by what Nina's talking about and that segment of protesters and being mm-hmm. involved in there and showing that the powerful depiction of a woman and that leading to that action. I mean, love that you pulled that out. I would love to, just before we go to Tony, Danilo, I would love to just get a sense from you. How do you remember how you came up with it being Nina being the one being chosen to depict in this role?
How Nina became the one? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's a couple of things. Working with yourself and your organization as well as with Poetry Jazz Cafe. It's like an epic moment, as you implied, like going over Miles Davis. It had to be another person who was like so impactful. And, I'm here actually at Poetry Jazz Cafe right now, transmitting live. But you could see, you got Nina here, you got Miles, you got Muhammad Ali. Like the message had to be powerful and had to be someone that was so instrumental, like Nina. I guess one thing that, like for me, as an Afrofuturist artist, recreating these kind of narratives, as Nalo, hopefully I'm saying your name right, brother. Nalo was saying, there's the original image of Rosie the Riveter, but like bringing it into context with Nina Simone and a Black woman who, was such a prominent, powerful activist and through her music and through her call to action. As an Afrofuturist, it's like reinterpreting these narratives. The importance of us coming into the frame, around environmental justice. So Nina Simone was definitely like the perfect person to bring all of these themes together. It's like music as well and artistry combined with activism for environmental justice. It was just the perfect meshing.
And if I can just tie that off.
Sorry, hold on. I gotta cut you off, son.
Cut me off.
I just did that for fun,
Yeah.
Just to keep it loose, but also one of the important parts for my, I think for us, and we discussed this as we were working, was you can see some African fabric patterns in the head wrap, as well as in her blue, shirt, and so that was also another way of bringing it back to this like reinterpreting of the original image. So it's still blue, and her head wrap is, or her, I guess in the original it was like a bandana or whatever, but with Nina, it was, it's a head wrap, and there's these African fabric patterns, representing, people of African descent throughout the diaspora, and just tying that in subtle ways, and then also in beautiful, colorful ways and bold ways, celebrating our Blackness and just, as Black people and people of color, and all incorporating that in. So I just had to, talk about that
And I'm glad you did, because that immediately reminded me of the first, because I mean, this is not, it's an artistic piece. There's interpretation, it's not
unique
creation. Yeah. And so I remember the first time we had a passerby look at her and realize that connection between Rosie and Nina, and then it being a reinterpretation of that.
Before the quote
went up, that was before environmental justice sign was up there, and Danilo and I literally danced in the street because that's
that challenge, right? We were ecstatic.
Without being completely literal, to still kind of make a nod to it and adapt it. So I mean, already I gave Danilo, or we as a team gave Danilo that challenge of, okay, so we need you to create an environmental justice piece. Hold on, there has to be a World War II aesthetic to it. And if you didn't think that was hard enough, it's going on the legendary Poetry Jazz Cafe in Kensington Market over the Miles Davis. And if we want this piece to stay up, then it's gotta be relevant musically, because we're working with a local business who's choosing to take the step to support this messaging, who's taken down a piece that has defined his life's passion in his business and the role of that person in the community. And he's choosing to use that space to support a particular message. So how do we then take that World War II aesthetic, take environmental justice and the relevance of that music and arts play, and make sure that we communicate that in there? So I think you did an incredible job doing so. And I would love, Tony, I would love to hear, do you think you did that successfully, or do we need to remove you from this partnership?
Danilo, I mean, the mural is beautiful. I have been just sitting here reflecting on how grateful I am to have been able to support it in any like small way, and also just like to hear from you in terms of all of your insights into and your artistic choices that went into this. And I mean, obviously everything Andre just said, yes, I agree. Obviously, we don't need to kick me out. But I was wondering specifically about the choice of the background, actually. Because it looks like, is it a starry night sky? Was that the background choice? Or what was that?
That was snow.
Might have been snow. Might have been snow, because she was shooting Brett, you know, a great photographer, videographer. She was shooting it right now, you know.
Oh, okay.
February 19th, and it was So yeah, there's no Starry Night reference.
So is it just black?
Yeah, it's like a faded into black, so that Nina really like comes forward.
Fabulous. I was just curious. I was like, I wonder, is there some because art is this like universal language, and I was like, oh, maybe that's what he's trying to get across. But I love that it's just snow. I love snow. It's my favorite thing. But no, I think this is such an important piece. Reflecting about how we need to move forward, and the fact that in this piece there is a specific call out to not only Black people but also to white people because mm-hmm. of Nina Simone's words, I thought was so important.
Yeah,
because not just, I think it's easy to think like, oh, environmental justice is this thing like, you know, certain communities are impacted by but not others, and that's totally not true, right? Especially, and if you look more broadly at climate change and all of the other struggles we're facing, like this is very much a problem that is going to touch all of us and is a problem that needs all of us to get together and fix it. And so this is very much a call in mural as opposed to like a highlight of a specific community, which I really appreciated a lot because I think that's so, so critical. And then also what I really liked about it is because the background is in fact like quite simple and isn't like specifically located, it's one of those things that will apply now and it will apply in the future. And like coming at this in Black History Month, I think it's so cool because it like pulls the past into the future and will be relevant going forward. And I think that's also so powerful. So there was just so many different things that I've been sitting here reflecting on about why I love this piece. So thank you. Fabulous.
Thank you, Tony.
I feel like I just nodded through that. I don't know how distracting that was with the whole time. It was like, yes, yeah. And speaking to a Black background and the choice for that to focus on the face, I think that was even that was a difficult decision because environmental justice is not a simple topic. I mean, Lynn and Tony, I've been seeing you, we've been the only Black people at most climate activist events in the city most of the time when we've been there. This coming onto the radar and having to unpack that. I remember when we first brainstormed as a partner team, being like, okay, what do we want to see in here? And all of us, of course, are like, okay, these are the 9 solutions, most important solutions for environmental justice. How do we get all of those in this one piece? So I'd love to know, I think the reason I want to throw to the partners is, I mean, obviously we know we've decided to make this into a series to make sure we capture all of that as we continue to do these pieces around Toronto. But do you, I guess just a quick question was, do you feel like that we found that balance in here for the first piece to make sure that we're announcing this as a series, but still making up of the tie to the fight that we're trying to further here?
Absolutely. The second question I was going to ask, if we have time, Danilo, was the image on the bottom left-hand side with picketers that really resonates with me as a trade unionist, and CBTU gives voice to Black trade unionists. Why did you choose that image to make that connection to the broader mural?
So we discussed, several different, different applications in terms of how to tie this portrait into, and then also include the multiplicity of the community, right? And the idea of, protest, but also like taking action and, We looked at several different options. I think what we came up with was the simplicity of just like the silhouettes, because it could be anybody, because that's how, this movement is. Having one, something that was more close up, just in terms of that, the visual aesthetic, having something that was close up with somebody holding a sign, and then having but making sure we also had several other people in the background, holding up signs, and it's taken from like several images and then drawing them and then reinterpreting them, of course, with aerosol and spray paint and graph graffiti. So, it's taken, from all those kind of, from several different images and, people holding up signs as well as that one specific person in the image in the foreground, even though that's in the background of the entire image, and creating that visually creating that depth, but in a sense, I guess, also creating that depth in terms of the message that, Nalo alluded to, like, it's not just one person, it's several people. Like, it's a collective movement that needs to take place, and that is taking place. It continues to take place. So,
if I can throw in my 2 cents from when Danilo and I were having this discussion and collaborating together. I know one of the things that we loved about it was that not only did he put people holding up signs, but people reaching up for it. And that was something that resonated with us, that it's not environmental justice isn't just here, it's something that we're striving for. It's something that we're fighting for. So not all of them are holding up signs. Some of them are reaching up to show the kind of, that we don't have this yet. It's what we're fighting in order to get. This is how artists and the rest of us can work together to fight for that. And again, the last part of that specific action being so relevant now is last year we saw the most impactful public demonstrations fighting for climate, raising the awareness of environmental justice and climate solutions as a whole, we can't do that right now. And actually, sorry, not last year, 2019. Years just don't exist anymore, clearly. So for the fact that in this year of public art, that we still can't demonstrate together in the streets, and that the role of this mural series is to help try and fulfill that the role that demonstrations have been doing in terms of raising our awareness, public education, and mobilizing. So for me, when we came to the conclusion to have that section in there, I just thought was just a great way to balance everything together, and I was overjoyed that he was able to work that in successfully. I want to be mindful of time. We've got 3 minutes left. I just wanted to see. So number one, just so you guys know, anyone who missed the video earlier, we're gonna close out by playing the video with the volume on. And so I just want to, if we can just quickly go through each team member and get their last say, the last line that they want to leave anyone with, and that could be about the piece. We didn't get into a lot of your organizations and the work. We've got bios and all of that up for people who want to look deeper, but whatever you want to leave people with, we can go from there. So why don't we, I'll call out after each person. Why don't we start with Chris? I feel like you look ready to say something. So
I would say in a lot. I'm going to be very short. Just thank you for this wonderful piece of work. It's magnificent.
Thank you, Chris. And Tony, what would you like to leave everybody with?
I think similar to Chris, just gratitude, so much gratitude. Thank you, Danilo and Andre, for putting this all together. It's been fabulous. And I'm so excited to go see this in real life. It's going to be great.
Yeah.
And also hang out there and be like, yo.
Yeah.
Show.
Thank you, Tony. Nolo?
Yeah, I'm really grateful just being part of this. Maybe I can end with like a call to action saying, let's make this a start, not just the end of a project. It needs to be the start of something. And we can use that to have more conversations on the topic. So,
absolutely. Absolutely. Definitely let's let this be the start or the continuation of what's come before as well. Lynn.
Ooh. I think obviously a huge thank you. Like the vision is just like beyond, and I'm so grateful for all of you guys and for the artist as well. Thank you, Danilo. I think what I want to leave people with is just the message that like we are the change. We are the revolution. Like this is us. This is it. Like this whole thing exists because, you know, Andre was like, I'm going to do this thing. And like, it's going to come to fruition and like, it's going to make an impact and other people are going to see it and it's happening. So I just think cool that, you know, we are it. This is it. We can't wait for anyone else to save us. Like we gonna do the work and I'm happy to be doing it with y'all.
Awesome. Awesome. Thank you. And happy to be doing with you as well. Danilo, you want to hit us?
Well, I think, you know, honestly, to you know, roll on what Lynn was saying, we could give a hand to Andre, you know, for bringing us together, you know what I mean? And the whole crew, you know what I mean? The whole crew, Kate and the whole crew, you know what I'm saying? Again, also, yeah, that... it's important for, you know, Black people and people of color and people throughout our community to become engaged. You know, that is using this as a, you know, inshallah, as a call to action. And for me, you know, when this project came to me, when Andre was talking to me about it, and saying, you know, how much time you don't see racial BIPOC people within this realm enough, or people of color in this realm doing this activism, but it's so important and it affects us, you know what I mean? We can find benefits through it. Again, you know, benefits and sustainability through it. And it's important for us to all, you know, all be a part of that, this realm, and represent within this realm. So again, yeah, it was a blessing to be a part of creating this and being a part of this as an artist. Thank you. Blessings.
Thank you. I mean, thank you. I can't barely express how thankful, I mean, I can't do justice to how thankful I am. It's the moments at 4 a.m. on Wednesday night when those last pieces are going on and Danilo's been out there in minus 14 degree weather for 11 hours straight, where you get filled with that motivation and you feel the work and you feel the emotions connected to doing something that is relevant, that we're trying to help and move things forward in every way that we can. Each of us brings our own skill set. The whole purpose of us bringing arts into this is to highlight the fact that everyone has a way to contribute to solutions. And this is what the rest of our series will be focused on, is solutions. They exist. Environmental justice solutions will be always depicted in our series. We call out to communities who want to see this messaging representing their communities and see this public awareness and education being represented in their communities. We want to work with you. We want this messaging in your communities and we want you to be represented in this. So we call out to artists, we call out to local businesses, developers, you're developing in a neighborhood that shows some respect for that neighborhood.
That's right. And
help bring it together.
That's right.
We want to create the space for those who may not be familiar with this topic, which is that we could have just had this whole conversation just defining what environmental justice is. And so the amount of awareness that needs to go out there, we're never going to be able to create that in just one piece, but hopefully this helps inspire others to join in this process with us and take control of our narrative. As we said, the World War II scale level of mobilization is what we need in every way in order to not just survive, but to thrive in the future that we face. Part of that is the World War II scale propaganda, and let's create that narrative. The government took control of creating that beforehand, which is why it was so problematic. Let's take that power, let's create the images, let's highlight those climate solutions together so that they are representative and helpful and drive what we actually want to see on the other side of that. So I could go on forever. I probably have already. I would be remiss if I didn't take this moment, number one, to call out the other way we're going to be getting people engaged is, we're launching merch. T-shirts, tote bags, and sweaters. Because again, people's lives are busy, and the proceeds of that will go towards to the continuation of this work. So if that's an easier way for you to get involved, then that would be wonderful. So that's going to go live later this month. We've got a call out to photographers to come out, and whoever's creating the dopest rendition of the mural, that's who's going to go on that. So we want to highlight artists and photographers to give them that opportunity to weigh in. And I think that's how we have to continually think of things, is how do we create avenues for people to support this work that are natural to them. So I just wanted to call that.
What's the hashtag? What's the hashtag?
Hashtag climate art while apart.
Okay.
That's going to be defining our whole series. Nice. Hashtag climate art while apart. Also, if you go to our Instagram or jump on our mailing list, we've got a GoFundMe live. So at all proceeds from that go to the continuation of this work and to ensuring that the artist is compensated and respected in this work and their role is acknowledged for doing that. So anyone who has any questions for that, please feel free, call us out, ask us for transparency. We're not afraid of it. We're very proud of the way that we've structured this. The artists we're working with, I think, speak to that. I want to thank Sean from Poetry for allowing us to work with him and allowing us to have his space and for him to use it in this way. Getting closer with Sean through this process has been amazing. We've got a whole interview with Sean separately that we'll share with you. To the amazing community of Kensington, the local businesses that brought us free coffee, that brought us food to make sure we were nourished through this process, mm-hmm. their appreciation while us having to be distanced was incredible. And then finally, I'd like to go, there's one person on this call. Kate, are you on the call still? Can you come on the video? Yes. This, for those of you who don't know, this is Kate Hembley, who's the team lead for Canadian Climate Challenge in the School for Climate. And she is, there's nothing that we accomplish that Kate isn't in the background ensuring that it happens. So she, as with most people, volunteers as well, who are behind the scenes, sometimes we really just have to stop and appreciate their work and realize that we wouldn't be here without their work too. So thank you, Kate. Thank you to all of the partners on this call. Thank you to all of our future bookings. Keep an eye out as we continue to cover the city with beautiful climate art. And please reach out and get involved. Thank you for taking the time out today. Enjoy the rest of your weekend. And what will I'll play us out with the creation video, with the actual volume for those of you keeping it. And so you guys can get to see it. All right.
Nice.
All right. Great to connect Woo! With all of you.
Great Blessings. To connect. Danilo, what's your favorite Nina Simone song?
I think it's Strange Fruit.
Oh, powerful.
Yeah. The dark side. I think that is true of our painters, truth, sculptors, poets, musicians.
As far as I'm concerned, it's their choice. I choose to reflect the times and
can everybody else hear this? I, for some reason, lost sound.
I don't hear anything.
Not seen the video yet, I guess. Is that just mine?
No, I think we're having technical difficulties.
I can see it. Yes, I can see it, but I can't hear it.
Oh, you can't? Okay, cool.
I'm going to go and assume the sound is not working.
It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Yeah, it's a new dawn. It's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh, 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 ooh. And I'm feeling good.
Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you all for all of you who've stuck with us this long. I hope you appreciate the video and all the incredible work that Brett did in order to put that together. And really just capturing the positive spirit. We know this topic is filled with a lot of very difficult weight. And we know that how that can cause that divide. And I want it to be clear that this is, we've all made a choice together as the partners in this to bring that positive energy, to show what working on those solutions, how rewarding that is. And that is a conscious choice that we have made in order to help facilitate more people getting involved in that work. So it's truly been beautiful working with you all. I can't wait to continue on the next one. I will probably sleep most of the weekend before we get to doing that. And hopefully it's not in February or March for the next one. So
no.
Thank you very much, everyone. Bye for now, and we'll chat soon.
Thank you, Andre. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Have a good night.
Blessings.
But why?
Because it's not done in the video.
Yeah, but. Okay, but twist it so that I can see, so I know when to stop it. Yeah, so I know. Yeah, because then I'll stop. Because right now, everything that I'm streaming.
Yeah, you're almost at it.
Hold up, please.